Hi everyone, Piet Callemeyn here. I hope you're having an awesome day. So welcome again to a video in the wearable design project. In this video, we are going to tackle the power management system. Now again, we are designing a wearable heart rate sensor. It should be low power, of course. It will have an internal battery. So how can we optimally design that power management system? That's what we're going to delve into today. So first of all, The first thing we're going to look into is battery choice. It should, of course, be a relatively small battery because it will be a wearable system. It should be relatively small. So we'll look into that first. Then power gating, we already dealt with that a bit in the video on the sensing system. So there's a couple of systems that can be shut off with actual power gates. I'm going to recap that today. But then the main thing today will be looking into charging and power conversion, how to do that optimally on a very small footprint for this wearable design. Now let's first look at our battery choice. So I would propose that we're going to use a lipo battery, a rechargeable battery. There's an awful lot of possibilities over there. The nice thing is that relatively small batteries exist. For instance, this one, it's 110 milliamp hours, which is already relatively big for our system, or certainly sufficient. It's 35 millimeters in width, let's say, 19 in height. So this might be maybe a bit already on the larger side, a bit depending on the housing, of course, that we're going to use. There's smaller alternatives as well, but I am relatively happy with this 35 to start with. Then let's go back to our sensing system. So if you recall from that video, we have been evaluating this heart rate sensor from Maxim. There's also an evaluation kit that exists for that one. And that will help us today because what you see over here is a small power management circuit. It's a buck boost converter. So it will generate, based from a 3.3 volt supply, it will generate the LED supply, which is at 5 volts in our case, and a 1.8 volt supply that we would need for the I/O part on that sensor. This one, the buck boost converter, is able to generate both the 5 volts and the 1.8 volts from a 3.3 volt supply. So that could be an ideal choice for us. And the nice thing is we have that schematic over here. Now, if you then look into that power management solution, you see that we have the boost regulator. We can boost all the way up to 5 volts, which is ideal. There's a relatively low quiescent current. Same thing for the buck regulator. There's a relatively low quiescent current in there. And then even for the LDO, it's relatively small, the quiescent current. So this is a good one to go for. So let's start with that design. So if you have a look at that buck boost converter, it's a relatively simple topology. So there's a 3.3 volts that we're going to supply. Then there's a separate output that is going to be generated that is software configurable. So there we are going to step all the way up to that 5 volts. This is what we will call V-source LED. And then same thing for the LDO output, we're going to step it down to 1.8 volts, the 1.8 that we need for our sensor as well. Control over here is via I2C, so there's an SCL SDA line. Then there's a bit of configuration bits. This is the control as well that will come from your microcontroller to enable the buck boost converter. And there is, of course, an inductor in there as well that is needed. So this DC-DC converter will generate the voltages that we need. So 1.8 and 5 volts. If you look indeed in the sensing system, what we have done there is power gating of these two. So there's the source that is coming from that buck boost. There's the LED source also coming from that buck boost. And from within the MCU, we can activate the 1.8 and the LED voltages. So that's an interesting way to have the power gating. We can shut it down completely. We can also do that with this pin. We can also do it in software configuration so that the quiescent current when the heart rate sensor is not being used is as small as possible. So that's the design of that buck boost DC-DC converter. Then, of course, we need to charge the battery. And that's a more, let's say, complex thing. Well, there's a relatively simple way to go or a more complex way to go. So we have that lipo battery. I'm going to show you the simple option first. So this is a well-known option and it's all hardware configured. So there's no configuration over I2C that you need to do. It's one of the most simple options, but a nice option to use. And that could be done with an MCP controller. It just needs, for instance, a USB power supply that you provide. The battery is attached over here and this thing will completely do the charging for you as it should be done. You select the regulation voltage by choosing the correct type, and then your battery will be charged. Also, there is a way to have in parallel, if there is a USB system present, to do both the charging and feeding of the system. So that's a well-known system to use. It's an easy system. The drawback a bit in this one here is that you need to put an extra step as an LDO. So in terms of footprint, it becomes a bit bigger. It's a simple option, but in terms of footprint, a bit bigger. Also from this one, there is no BGA variant available. So for our wearable design project, I wanted to get everything as small as possible. I was looking for a charging system in a BGA IC, also already with an LDO on board. And then after a couple of searches, this turned out to be an interesting one for our project. Of course, we can make a complete video series on charging and charger ICs. This is the one I set out to use in this project. So it's a BQ from Texas Instruments 21062. It has everything that we need. It's a one cell 500 milliamps battery charger. That's good. And there's also a power pad and an LDO available. Basically, what I want to have in my charger is also the option to generate my 3.3 volts for this system. That should be lower than 150 milliamps load, but of course, in what we are doing, that is not a problem at all. So let's look at the maybe a bit more complex charger design that we made, but still very much understandable. So we are going to power that charging IC with the VUSB. So I have placed near our MCU, that was not there in the previous video, I've placed the USB connector. It's a micro USB connector, so relatively small. That will enable us to have USB connectivity to the modem slash controller. And also, there's, if we are going to put in the cable, there's a VUSB, there's around 5 volts of supply voltage available. That is what we're going to use to charge our battery. So that's present over here. There's a couple of pins that we could use, but we can leave them floating. There's no real need here in our project to have them connected. The connectivity and the configuration will be done over I2C. There's also a shipping button. Basically, the system will put everything in a very deep sleep mode so that there's no parasitic current draw from the battery unless people start using the system. So that could be interesting to prevent, let's say, your batteries being drained on the shelf. So that's that. Then there's a PMID, voltage being generated. We are not going to use that in our case because we need 3.3 volts. The PMID will always be a bit higher than the battery charge voltage. So in our case, that's above 4.2 volts, which is too high. But we have this LDO available. We can configure it to be at 3.3 volts, and that is exactly what we will need. So this voltage, this is all integrated in that IC. It's a relatively small IC, it's a BGA. So very small footprint to do a lot of the stuff that we need, both charging and having the 3.3 volts. And then last but not least, there's a JST connector over here. I've chosen the 3 pins. We'll see in the next video if we're going to lay out everything together, if this is too large or not. But there's a battery terminal, a ground terminal, and then a thermistor connection. So that brings us to, let's say, the full design. It's a relative simple schematic design, but it's to give you an idea in how you would design a wearable system. So we have now our power system. Basically, the only connectivity or connection with the MCU is to enable that. Then there's an I2C line, and that I2C line is also shared between the microcontroller and the heart rate sensor. So that's basically it. Again, this is maybe a bit more complex than it could be, but if you look at the size constraints, then I think it's a good choice that we made over here. So in our next video, we are going to take all these schematics and put them in a layout, make it as small as possible. So that will be the last phase in our wearable design project. Looking forward to seeing you in that video. Bye-bye.